بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. والحمد لله رب العالمين، بارئ الخلائق أجمعين، باعث الأنبياء والمرسلين، ثم الصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء وسيد المرسلين حبيب إله العالمين المصطفى أبي القاسم محمد. وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المنتجبين الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا. صلى الله عليك يا سيدي ويا مولاي يا أبا عبد الله، صلى الله عليك يا ابن رسول الله يا غريب كربلاء. رزقنا الله في الدنيا زيارتكم وشفاعتكم في الدنيا والآخرة، أما بعد، فقد قال الله تبارك وتعالى في كتابه المجيد وقرآنه الحميد وقوله الحق: أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. وكان له ثمر فقال لصاحبه وهو يحاوره: أنا أكثر منك مالا وأعز نفرا. ودخل جنته وهو ظالم لنفسه قال: ما أظن أن تبيد هذه أبدا، وما أظن الساعة قائمة، ولئن رددت إلى ربي لأجدن خيرا منها منقلبا. صدق الله العلي العظيم. صلوا على محمد وآل محمد. Continuing with our discussion from last night, just a brief introduction again for those of you who may not have been with us last night. Inshallah, over the next 10 or so nights that we'll be commemorating the tragedy of Al-Imam Al-Husayn Salamullahi Alayhi, we'll be reviewing some of the stories of the Quran and how they relate to the movement of Al-Imam Al-Husayn Salamullahi Alayhi, such that we can hopefully shed some light on some of the values of the movement of Al-Imam Al-Husayn Salamullahi Alayhi, and hopefully also understand and realize that this movement stems from the Holy Quran, is based on the teachings of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and the Holy Quran. And it also relates to the human and his values and innate needs. So last night, we briefly spoke about the story of Mu'min Surah Yasin. In Surah Yasin, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us an example of a Mu'min whom we said that the Quran does not mention his name, but history tells us his name was Habib al-Najjar, who became a Mu'min who believed in the messengers that the Prophet Isa alayhi salam sent to a city by the name of Antioch. And this Habib, upon seeing that the city has belied these prophets, three messengers, they did not respect what they're saying. He took it upon himself to go and help out and participate in spreading the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to educate his community, to educate his people. And we said that It is the responsibility of each and every one of us to spread the message of Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam in whatever way we can, whatever means we are capable of. Some mu'mineen, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given them the ability with technology. They're really good with the internet, social media. That's one way you can serve. Some mu'mineen are very good with finances. That's a great way of serving. I met a mu'min recently who is really good with arts. He's an artist. He's using his arts in some of the Western countries to spread the message of Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam by holding exhibitions. That's his means of spreading the message of Ahlul Bayt alayhim. Whatever means we can, we need to go ahead and pursue it. We also need to establish an institution that looks after the affairs of Muslims, that becomes proactive as opposed to reactive to the affairs of the Muslims. And that's a responsibility on all of us. That's one lesson we learn also from Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam and his movement on the day of Ashura, when he moved to Karbala, salamullahi alayhi. Although he realized he doesn't have many supporters, he does not have much. However, that did not stop him from going ahead and trying to spread justice and go through this revolution. And indeed, he became successful, salamullahi alayhi. So that's a lesson for all of us, brothers and sisters, to really try to be active, to keep on moving, become dynamic. Today, inshallah, we will shed some light on a different story in the Quran. The story is from Surah Al-Kahf. In the story, Allah gives us an example of an individual whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him a lot of wealth. Quran describes this wealth as two gardens, big, large gardens. In between them runs a river. These gardens bear fruit all year long. The problem is, this individual, and instead of thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for what he has given him, instead, he started feeling independent, wal'iyadu billah, from Allah, that I don't need anyone anymore. I have wealth, I have money, I have everything that I need. And so I don't need anyone else. And I don't think this will ever perish. This is going to be everlasting. These investments of mine are not going to die. They're pretty good. And in addition, he says, and if there is a time when we will return back to Allah, if he has given me so much in dunya, then I could only imagine what he's left for me in akhirah. If this is what he's given me now, then obviously he's going to give me much more. This is his logic. That's his logic. Before going on, I'd like to give a brief introduction here. The stories of the Quran are relevant to our lives. They relate to us. We should study them, look after them. You know, I remember when I was an undergraduate, doing my undergraduate degree, in the English class at the university, we had to study one of the Shakespearean plays. I don't know, do you study Shakespeare here? Yeah. So there's a play called Hamlet. I don't know if you guys are familiar with Hamlet. There was that very, very famous quote, you know, to be or not to be, that is the question. That comes from Hamlet, you know, that play. Anyways, so one day I was having a conversation with the instructor of the class. And she said that, this was back when I was doing my undergrad degree, you know, several years ago. Some of you were not even born, you know, so not that I'm old or anything, but, you know, just still. So back then, she said, at that time, there were 3,500, approximately, research articles that were written about Hamlet. Research articles mean people at the university study Hamlet. You know, they study Hamlet. They actually write about him. They study his behavior. Hamlet had some problems, psychological issues. Why did he have psychological issues? What caused him to have all this? Why did he behave in such a way? And remember, this is a play. This is like fiction. It's not even real. So I told that instructor, I said to her, you know, but Hamlet is fiction. He's not even real. He's the creation of Shakespeare. Why would 3,500 research articles be written about a fictional character? Someone who's not even real. Maybe if you tell me that there are 3,500 research articles written about Shakespeare, maybe I can digest that. At least he's a real human being. He was a man of literature. He's written plays. Okay, that maybe I can digest. But a fictional character in a play. What's the point of this? She replied, and listen to the answer. That was quite intriguing. The answer was, no, that's not true. We need to study Hamlet because he represents reality. Hamlet went through some problems in his childhood, some trauma that caused him to become what he became. If we study his character, this can help us also understand the human psychology. So if we understand Hamlet, this can give us some understanding on the reality, on some real life, on some real people, and why they behave in certain ways. So it's important to analyze and study Hamlet. This was the response. So at that point, I thought, subhanAllah, you know, there are fictional characters are being studied so that we can learn lessons from them to implement it in real life. What about the Quran? What about Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam? Why don't we study them? Analyze their character, they're real. And they're the best and most perfect model. So why not study and analyze those stories, which are real? The stories in the Quran, they relate to us. Because at the end of the day, human beings have the same driving forces. Every human being, my brothers and sisters, every action that we do stems from three driving forces. First is desire. That's your first driving force. So we eat because we have a desire. We become hungry. So we eat. We drink, for example, water because of the desire for thirst. We're thirsty, so we need water. That's a desire. So that's what's driving these things. You have a desire to sleep. So we sleep. That's one driving force. Another driving force is anger. Anger. Sometimes people get into an argument, and unfortunately one of them gets angry a little bit and loses his control and throws a punch at the other individual. And very sadly, I heard yesterday there was such an event here. You know, it's not the akhlaq of the followers of Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam in the majlis of Imam al-Husayn alayhi as-salam to have such characters. We need to learn from Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam when we attend their majalis to have also their a character, their akhlaq, embedded in us. Nonetheless, what stemmed that punch from happening? Anger. A person got angry, and it happened. That's the second reason why people act or are driven to do their actions. A third driving force is the mind, the aql. The aql. The aql controls. For example, these days, Salatul Subuh is approximately at about 5 a.m. The alarm goes off at 5 a.m. approximately. And your aql says, okay, get up. Now it's time for Salat. You need to get up. Your desire says, shut it off and go back to sleep. No, I'm tired. I don't want to get up. It's too early in the morning. You know. So now here you have an internal struggle. Who wins? Your aql, your mind, or your desire? The aql is saying, I know you're tired, but Allah says you have to get up and pray. So get up, pray. Do your salat and then go back to sleep if you want to. Or even better, you should stay up and read a little bit of Quran. Do some dua. There is in the hadith, after every wajib salat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you a bonus. And that bonus is a dua that is accepted. I see some mu'mineen after salat, they immediately jump and start conversing. Having a conversation. Just wait a little bit. Wait. Make a dua. It's a bonus from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's giving you a freebie. You pray to Allah. You do the salat. Allah says, I will accept a dua, a haja for you. And which one of us does not have a haja or some need? Okay. Inshallah, your dua is answered at that point. So your aql is telling you, your mind is telling you, let me stay up, let me read a little bit of Quran. Imam Ar-Ridha alayhi salam says, every mu'min on a daily basis should read 50 verses of the Quran. 50 verses. If you can do it after Salatul Fajr, great. If you can't, stagger them, no problem. Read, for example, 10 verses, then later 10 verses until you get 50. If you have a problem reading Arabic, mashallah, these days we all have these technologies with us, these things, and they have everything in here. So listen to it. Listen to 50 verses and follow along. It will literally not take you more than 15, 20 minutes to read about 50 verses of the Quran. That's what your aql is telling you. Let me do this. Okay. Your desire is saying, no, I want to sleep. Now you're at war. You're in combat. Who's going to win? Unfortunately, in most cases, you hit the snooze button and you go back to sleep. Okay. And the alarm goes off again. The exact same thing happens until you say, oh, khalas, the sun has risen, too late. Yallah, let me go back to sleep now. You know. And by the way, just for your information, this is considered a major sin. If you wake up during the time of the salat, so for example, you will get up at 5:15, for example. If you wake up and you realize it is the time of salat, then you have to get up and pray. If you decide to go back to sleep, that's just counted against you, that you deliberately missed a time of salat. And may Allah not make us among those who deliberately missed the time of salat. فَوَيْلٌ لِلْمُصَلِّينَ الَّذِينَ هُمْ عَنْ صَلَاتِهِمْ سَاهُونَ. Woe to those who pray, but they take their salat lightly. They don't really care. You know, I pray, I don't pray, it's okay. Some brothers and some sisters, they go to school, they go to university. They're like, you know, it's okay. I'll go back home and then I'll do my salat. Qadha, no big deal. No, it is a big deal, brothers and sisters. The salat is a gift from Allah to us. Let us use it. When you pray the salat, really, you feel this comfort. Now, some people would say, you know, I don't feel that comfort. I just pray really quickly and even that prayer that you pray quickly, you may think it has no value. You may think that it does. The fact that you actually remember, I need to pray. The fact that you actually go, do your wudu, and then you come and stand facing the qibla. All this, you're submitting to Allah. Allah has told you, do all these things. This is all submission to Allah. The fact that you say, Allahu Akbar, you start reciting verses of the Quran, doing your rukus, that all is part of submission. All these have effects, have values. You may not see them, you may not realize them, but they are doing a major role on you. They're reminding you of your submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So they're important. They're very important. These are constant struggles we have. And these are the three driving forces. There is a fourth one, a fourth driving force. But some of the ulama see it as a hindering force as opposed to a driving force. And they call it the force of imagination. What is force of imagination? For example, suppose someone comes and sleeps next to a dead body. You know, there's a dead body. A person comes and sleeps next, spends the night next to it. You know, that person may not sleep the whole night. Keeps on looking at this dead body and like, you know, maybe it'll get up, you know, maybe it'll just do something. This is all imagination. Of course, it's a dead body. Nothing will happen. But his fear of his imagination would prevent his desire of sleep. That's why it's looked more as opposed a hindering force as opposed to a driving force. So we'll keep that one aside for the time being because that's an imaginative force. The three driving forces, we said, what are they? First of all is what? Desire. Second is anger. And the third is the mind, the aqil. Now, desire is good because without desire, we would go on without eating. None of us would want to have children, so the humanity could go in extinction. This desire is good, but if it's controlled, if it's controlled. Allah says, "Kulu washrabu wa la tusrifu." Eat and drink, but don't extravagate in moderation. You need to control it. That desire needs to be controlled. Anger is a good thing because you need anger in war. If it were there were no anger, no one would fight in battles. One of the reasons people fight is because they're angry. They get angry, you know, they get that adrenaline rush. So they go and fight, and that's a good thing. They need, you know, you need people to fight and stand for justice, to defend humanity. So that's a good thing. But if it's controlled, otherwise you'd have problems. The aql's job, the mind's job is to control the desire and the anger. Keep them in track. But it is up to us to allow the mind to control or to allow the desire to control or the anger to control. And that's where the problems happen, brothers and sisters. And we live these days in an environment and society that is driven to stop the mind from working. In a society that's driven for desire. So you have, for example, the television today. And many of our youth are watching television and the shows that are on television. And they are being affected by what they see on television. In fact, according to communication theories, they've done research on this. When people watch television, advertisements, this marketing techniques, they subconsciously started to absorb these images. What they see on television, that it becomes reality to them, that this is reality. This is how things should be. And hence, marketing works. Television works. You can think about it. How many times do you remember a line of a movie, for example? You may have read a book, if you've ever experienced this. You may have read a novel or a story, and then you've watched a television, a movie of it. Which one sticks to your mind more? The novel that you read or the television, the movie that you watched? The movie sticks into your mind. How come? Because it engages you. It captivates you. It got all your senses intrigued in there. So people realize this has influence. Problem is, when we start watching what we watch today, what some of the youth are watching, and I don't want to mention some of these shows, but what values do they teach? In fact, none. The way that fashion is introduced today, look at the way people are dressed, and I mean men and women. One day I was at a mosque praying, and there was a man praying in front of me, a young man. Every time we go to ruku, I had to close my eyes. Do you know what I mean? Just don't understand, yani, akhi. You're praying in the masjid. Couldn't you get a shirt that's a bit longer? Fashion, that's a fashion today. Fashion, we set the standards of fashion according to the standards of Islam, the standards of Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam. Our sisters as well, when we talk to them about hijab, hijab is put there for a reason, brothers and sisters. Allah put hijab for a reason. Hijab for both men and for women. Hijab is not only for women, for men and women. There is a social component of hijab, which is very important. And that applies to both men and women. When you talk to ladies, when you talk to women who are strangers, talk to them with modesty, with respect. Not much joking around and laughing around. Speak with humbleness. Stay professional. Some of you may work. You have colleagues. No problem. But within the boundaries of the profession. And then there's the physical component of hijab, which is mandated upon the sisters. Now, a lot of sisters, sometimes they come to me, they say, well, you know, you tell us that we have to wear this hijab head to toe, basically cover the whole body with the exception of the face and the hands up to the wrist. So the whole body has to be covered with the exception of the face and the hands up to the wrist. The clothes that are worn should be loose, not tight, that they would reveal the figure. Some of the sisters would come and say, you know what, but we want to stay within the fashion. We want to wear, you know, these tight jeans and have these boots that go up to the knee height. You have this here as well? Do you have this fashion? Yeah. Okay. From the Sharia point of view, we have a problem with this kind of a dress. And then there's the makeup. I once asked some sisters, why do you wear makeup, you know, like the lipstick and the nail polish and all this in public? Do you know it's haram? They said, yes, but, you know, we want to look beautiful. I said to them, first of all, who do you want to please, Allah or people? People you'll never please. You'll never please them. Please Allah. Do what He wants. Do what He says. Second of all, why do you think that you're not beautiful and the makeup will make you beautiful? What? Have self-esteem. Believe in yourself. Believe in your confidence. I know one mu'min, she says, every year they have a walk for cancer, you know, especially women-related cancers. I don't know if you have them. I'm sure you have them here in Australia as well. You know, sometimes there's this walk where people walk for cancer to raise funds. This mu'min says, I wear my abaya and I walk. This is in Canada with my abaya, with my hijab. Said other women come to me, sisters, and they say, how could you be doing this with your abaya? She said, this is what the hijab is. Why can't I do it with my abaya? Let the world see that me with my abaya, I can do these things. I can raise money for cancer research. It doesn't stop me. And indeed, hijab does not stop you from progressing. Being modest, being kind, doesn't stop you, my brothers, my sisters. But we sometimes succumb to the social pressures. Some mu'mineen, especially those who work in the corporate world. Corporate world is very difficult. Those of you who work in the corporate world, you know what I'm talking about. They have sometimes some parties, dinners, luncheons, alcohol is being served. Some people go to these parties. And I ask them, why do you go? They say, well, you know, if I don't go, then I won't make connections. Without connections, I can't go up the ladder. I have to. And even worse, some people actually drink, wal'iyadu billah, alcohol. And they're asked, why do you do this? Say, only at work. You know, I don't do it outside. Only here because of social reasons. You know, we have to kind of go with the flow so that we can go up the ladder. Is this acceptable, brothers and sisters? Who are you pleasing? People, at the expense of who? Your religion? This religion is so great. Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam gave his life for this religion. He sacrificed everything he had, including his 6 months old baby, so that you and I can learn this religion and stay on the straight path. Can't we sacrifice a little bit on these social gatherings? Can't we sacrifice on the hijab, you know, such that we wear the right hijab, sacrifice the makeup, wear the right clothes and attire? Can't we do this? Some of the brothers are engaged in selling drugs, wal'iyadu billah. Drugs are a problem here. It's haram. It's not allowed. You're killing the society. You're killing the community. You're killing yourself. But unfortunately, the desire sometimes becomes very strong. I like the money. So it doesn't matter where I get it from. I need the money. I want it. I like to look beautiful. So it doesn't matter. Your aql is telling you, your mind is saying, this is not right. It's wrong. It's haram. But the desire, now it's at war. And it's up to you who wins the war. Your mind, your aql, or your desire. These driving forces need to be controlled. Quran relates to these issues. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us examples in the Quran, they're not hypothetical, they're real scenarios. Because those people also had these driving forces. They had this desire. They had the anger. They had their aql. So the example we see here in Surah Al-Kahf of this individual, who just because he had a little bit of money, thinks that, khalas, I'm untouchable now. And that we see it in reality. How many people in the community, the minute they have a little bit of money, or they have some kind of a degree, or they have a nice car, all of a sudden, khalas, everything I say must happen. Whatever I do, no one can question me. Who are you to question me? So this individual, he had a companion, sahib. His companion was not as rich as him. He started walking one day with him. His companion came to visit this man. His companion started to admonish him, educate him. Don't think like this. It's wrong. Allah gave you this ni'mah. Allah gave you this power. Allah gave you all this wealth. So every time you go into these gardens of yours, when you visit them, say, MashaAllah. La quwwata illa billah. That's what you should be saying. Think about Allah. And if you think I'm poor right now, Allah can destroy your whole wealth within a second. In 2008, when the financial crisis happened, some of you may remember, 2008, there were people who were billionaires. Literally, overnight, they lost everything. I was reading in the papers, few months after the financial crisis, few months, one German billionaire, a German billionaire, committed suicide because he lost everything. He's a billionaire, and he was 72 years old. Can you imagine? 72 years old, committed suicide. He couldn't stand it anymore. He lost everything in the financial crisis. He couldn't stand it anymore. So we see it live. How many presidents have we seen in our lifetime in the past 20 years, 15 years? How many presidents, prime ministers, they slept as presidents, they woke up either found in a hole or in a pipe or in the prison? How many times has that happened? We've seen this right in front of our eyes. And I wish the other kings and presidents learn. You'd think that they would learn. They see it right in front of their eyes. Oh, subhanallah, ya akhi. Blind. إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَيَطْغَى أَرْرَآهُ اسْتَغْنَى. The human being becomes oppressive, tyrant, as much as he feels independent. If I have $100, I'll become tyrant within the limit of 100. I have a million, I'll become tyrant within the limit of a million. And so on and so forth. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us the example of Fir'aun. Fir'aun is not a figure in history. We have so many Fara'een today. And Fir'aun does not necessarily mean the king. Sometimes you have a Fir'aun in the house with his wife, with his children, because that's his limit of power. If you give him the kingdom of Egypt, he also becomes a Fir'aun, like the Fir'aun, even worse. But he doesn't have it. So he's a Fir'aun with his wife, Fir'aun with his children. He destroys their lives. He ruins their lives. These are examples that are reality And we see some people like this. وَالْعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ. I get sometimes cases where, you know, husband and wife, unfortunately, they don't get along. Something happens, so a divorce happens. Although we try to counsel them, we try to educate them as much as we can, especially when there are children who are involved in the middle. Because unfortunately, a divorce tears children apart. Although we don't see it. We don't see it. Sometimes the kids are young. And I've had parents who tell me, no, we did this very quietly, discreetly. We really took care of the children. I tell them there is no such thing. Children can realize, can see the father is not there anymore or the mother is not there anymore. He wants his mother. He wants his father, but he doesn't see him. So that creates a reaction. The reaction, you see it, you observe it many years later. That's when you see it. He's being torn apart, this child. We don't realize it. So sometimes I tell them, for the sake of Allah, for the sake of your children, think for yourself for a minute, what pleases my imam? I have a living imam today. Is he pleased that I divorce him or I divorce her? Oh, you know what? Let me just be patient a little bit. Let me patient. Okay, maybe she's not perfect. Maybe he's not perfect, but let me try. Sometimes it doesn't happen, unfortunately, for whatever reason. Then you go to the husband, you say, okay, khalas, since you don't want her anymore, divorce her. Never. No. She's going to stay as long as I want. And I'm going to go marry a second one and a third one. No. I say, ya akhi, you know. And the problem is this person comes to the masjid, he prays. He's not, we're not talking about someone who's like, you know, out. I tell him, what kind of salat you're praying? If you don't want this lady, just let her go. Free her. Khalas. You want to get married? Khalas. Things didn't work out. All this counseling didn't work out. Let her go. No. And then you have to get people involved. You have, and so on and so forth. Until we find a solution for this young lady. Or for that mu'mina. What kind of akhlaq is this? That's a Fir'aun. But that's his limit. His limit is on this lady. That's how much limit he has. If you put such a man in charge of a company, look at what he becomes. He becomes a Fir'aun over his employees. If you give him a whole nation, he'll become a Fir'aun over this nation. So these are realities. These are people whom we can relate to. We see these examples. So when we come across the Quran, it gives us examples of real life. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted to discipline this man of the gardens. Indeed, just as his friend told him, his friend tried to wake him up, tried to educate him, but he would not listen. He goes to sleep at night. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala burns all his gardens and the river dries up. Wakes up in the morning, everything is gone. Everything. In one night. He starts looking at this and he starts going like this. يُقَلِّبُ كَفَّيْهِ as the Quran describes him. He goes like this. Alas. He's like, why did I do this? I shouldn't have done this. Now, he wakes up. When it's too late. When it's too late. These desires, my brothers and sisters, Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam tried to educate us. Tried to wake people up. So on the day of Ashura, salamullahi alayhi, when he looked at the army that's come to fight against him, thousands of people, what are they looking for? Either they're looking for governorship like Umar ibn Sa'd. Others are looking for a prize. Others are afraid. He's looking at these people. Their desire is taking them to Jahannam, wal'iyadhu billah. That's why Imam al-Husayn, salamullah alayhi, one of the values he stood up for is to awaken our minds, our aqil. He says, people, wake up. So in one of his sermons on the day of Ashura, he tried to remind people. He says, أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى خَلَقَ الدُّنْيَا فَجَعَلَهَا دَارَ فَنَاءٍ وَزَوَالٍ مُتَصَرِّفَةً بِأَهْلِهَا حَالًا بَعْدَ حَالٍ فالمغرور من غرت والشقي من فتنت فلا تغرنكم هذه الدنيا فإنها تقطع رجاء من ركن إليها وتخيب طمع من طمع فيها. So I need to educate these people. You people have all come to fight me. Do you know who am I? I'm the Prophet's grandson. Khadija is my grandmother. Fatima salamullah alayha is my mother. Ali is my father. Ja'far al-Tayyar is my uncle. Hamza is the uncle of my... This is my family. This is who I am. So he tells them, O people, indeed Allah the Exalted created this world. Allah created this world. And he made it a temporal place. We're not going to be staying here forever. You're going to be leaving this dunya. You're going to go. So when you think about watching the haram, wal'iyadu billah, let me remind myself, you know what? One day I'm going to go deep under in my grave. What am I going to answer? I'm going to tell to Allah, I watched the haram. I performed the haram. I did the haram. Some of the brothers, they engage in haram relationships. What for? You have the marriage. You have the halal. Why go to the haram? What answer will you give to Allah on the day of judgment? Allah will say, I gave you the halal. Why did you do the haram? What's your response? Why did you sell drugs? Why did you use drugs and alcohol? How come? Answer me. Why, my sister, you didn't put your hijab on the way that I wanted you to put your hijab on? How come? What's the answer? What are we going to say to Allah? Why did you oppress your parents, disrespect them? Why didn't you respect your wife or your husband, your children, your brothers and sisters in the community? Why did you backbite? What are we going to say? Imam al-Hussein is reminding them, wake up. He made this dunya a temporal place that will end and perish. It will end. It will change. It changes the state of its inhabitants from one form to another form. That could mean two things. The state of its inhabitants, maybe in dunya, just like that billionaire. One day he was a billionaire. The next day he became penniless. The state has been changed. And how many have we seen? One day a man was in the state of being a president. The next day he's in the prison. His state changes. The wheel keeps on turning. This is dunya. And it could mean another thing, that we in dunya, look at the way we are. When we go deep under, what's going to happen? Are we going to stay like this? This beautiful face is going to stay beautiful? Not anymore. It's going to go deep under. The worms are going to chew it up. They're going to eat it up. That's the reality. This is what's going to happen. So your state is going to change. The state is going to change. One day, Prophet Dawood, alayhi salam, he went to visit another prophet in his time by the name of Hizqil. Hizqil was living on a mountain. He was a prophet. He lived in a mountain. Sheikh al-Saduq in al-Amali narrates the story. He asked Hizqil, can I come and visit you? He said, come. So Prophet Dawood, alayhi salam, climbed the mountain and he started to have a conversation. He said, Hizqil, you spend your whole life worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Your whole life? He said, yes. He said, don't you ever feel that you're really good because you spend your whole life just worshipping Allah? He said, never. No matter how much I worship Allah, I'm not even doing justice to one meal that He provides me with. Who gives me my food? Allah. Who allows me to eat my food and digest it? Allah. Who allows me to breathe the air that I'm breathing right now? My heart is pumping right now. Allah. We don't even feel these things. How many times have you seen people, I don't know if you have, because of some illness, they are fed through tubes. They cannot feed, they cannot eat through tubes. Haven't we seen this? I've seen a man who cannot breathe on his own. He has tubes running in his nose and a machine to help him breathe. Something that we think is spontaneous for us. We don't even think about breathing. For him, he said, to me, breathing is an exercise. I have to put in effort when I breathe. All this ni'mah from Allah. He said to him, Allah is showering me with His blessings. He said to him, Ya Hizqil, you're living in this cave. or you're living on this mountain, don't you ever wish to have some of the attractions of dunya? You know, you may want to have a wife, you want to have children, you want to have money. Don't you want? He said, that does come across my mind sometimes. Yes. He said, so how do you resolve it? How do you solve this problem? He says, I go inside this cave and I learn from what's inside it. And then I come back. Can I go inside? Yes, you can. Dawood goes inside. He finds a skeleton lying on a bed made of rocks. And the pillow is made of iron. And next to it, there is a writing. He picks up the writing and reads it. It says, my name is Arwa ibn Aslam. I am a king. I ruled and built 1,000 cities. And I ruled for 1,000 years. But when my time came, the sand and the rock was my bed, and the iron became my pillow, and the snakes and the scorpions became my neighbors. So anyone who reads this, let him wake up that this world is not lasting forever. When are we going to learn? Imam al-Hussein is educating people. It changes the state. Your state is going to change. Not going to be like this forever. From one form to another. The arrogant is one deceived by this dunya, by it. And the wicked is the one lured by it. As you lure something, the dunya lures him. Come on. Enjoy yourself. Don't worry. Imam al-Hussein looked at Umar ibn Sa'ad. He tells Umar ibn Sa'ad, Ya ibn Sa'ad, you're killing me thinking that they will make you a governor of Iran? You're going to kill the Prophet's son so that he become a governor? You won't get it. You're not going to get it. Imam al-Hussein is telling him, but subhanallah, ya akhi. He goes ahead and he still does it. In fact, he takes the first arrow and shoots it at the camp of Imam al-Hussein. And he says, bear witness to Ubaidillah ibn Ziyad that I am the first one to shoot an arrow at the camp of Imam al-Hussein. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. What is this desire? That's why, brothers and sisters, Islam and Imam al-Hussein wants us to really keep these things in focus. Our salat, our siyam, our hijab. Not listening to the haram, not watching the haram, not doing the haram. Because God forbid, one day we're going to be dragged in and taken. Umar ibn Sa'ad used to pray. In fact, even on the day of Ashura, he prayed. What kind of salah is this? He prays on one side and then he goes to kill Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam. Let us learn. So he says, the wicked is the one lured by it. So do not let this world fool you. For it cuts the hope of the one who leans against it. You want help from dunya? No. Don't think like this. And it disappoints the greed of he who indulges in it. You indulge in dunya. What are you going to get? Nothing. Nothing. This is one of the values we learn on the day of Ashura. To keep our aql in focus. To control our desires. One of the companions of Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam on the day of Ashura, or the eve of Ashura, he tells him, Ya ibn Rasulullah, if they cut me into pieces and then they burn me and then they resurrect me again and they do the same thing to me 1,000 times, I would never leave you. I would never leave you. The desire of life is very precious. We all really want to stay alive. That's every human being. In fact, every living thing has a desire of life. Even if you take an ant, if the ant feels threatened, what happens? It starts running away. If any animal feels threatened, it runs away. Life. Life is precious. What makes this man give up his life? It's his aql. He realizes this is the akhirah. That's why we say to them, Bi abi antum wa ummi fustum fawzan azima faya laytani kuntu ma'akum fa afuza ma'akum. He says, if they cut me 1,000 pieces, they burn me, they resurrect me again, and they do the same thing to me 1,000 times, I would never leave you. How about it when it's only once, one time, one death, and we'll win eternity for it? That's the aql, that's the mind. That's one example. You have Umar ibn Sa'd, the other example. Now we need to choose who we want to be. Imam al-Hussein left from Mecca with about 1,000 men. 1,000 when he left Mecca. On the day of Ashura, he was left with how many people? 72 plus 18 family members. That's about how many? 90. Let's say 100 to make the math easy. 100. What's that percentage from 1,000? 100 from 1,000 is what percent? What happened to the 90%? What happened? 90%. Where did they go? When the test came, they failed. So how am I going to do? If I can't give up looking something haram, if I can't control my desire when it comes to wearing my hijab and not putting that makeup on, if I can't control my desire when I treat people with respect, I don't do that. If I can't treat my desire to pray salat on time, do you think really I'm going to defend the imam when he reappears? Do you think I'm really going to make it among that 10%? Inshallah. But we need to put in the effort. You put to the best of your ability. Let us try, brothers and sisters. Let us try. That's one thing we learn from Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam. On such a night, on that second day of Muharram, the caravan of Imam al-Hussein arrives in Karbala. They arrive there. Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam with his family members and some of his companions at that point, they arrive. He asks, he says, where are we? What is the name of this land? They said to him, it's known as Shatul Furat. This is the place where the banks of the Furat. There's a river here called Furat and we're next to it. He said, does it have any other name? They said to him, yes, it's also known as Karbala. He said, Ya Allah, Allahumma inna na'udu bika min al-karbi wal-bala. And then he turned to his companions. He says, oh Allah, I seek refuge in you from difficulties, calamities, afflictions. Then he turned to his family members, he turned to his companions. He said, this is where we're going to stay. This is where we are going to be killed. This is where our women will be taken as prisoners. This is where our children will be slain. And then he turned to Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas alayhi salam. He said, Ya Abu al-Fadl, dismount from your horse and set up the tents. And then come and take Zainab alayhi salam so that she can go inside her tent. And take my children. So Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas salamullah alayhi goes, start setting up the tents, setting up the place. After he sets everything up, he comes to Zaynab salamullahi alayha with all dignity, with all respect. Takes her inside her tent. Then he comes to the children of Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam, one after the other. Helps them dismount. Takes them into their tents. Looks after them. Brings them the food, the water, whatever they need. And this continues until the 11th day of Muharram. The 10th day of Muharram, on the 11th day, when the women and the children were about to leave Karbala, Zainab alayha salam looked to the river of Furat and said, أخي أبا الفاضل أنت الذي أركبتني إذا أردت الخروج من المدينة. Oh brother, Ya Abbas, you're the one who took care of me in Medina. You're the one who was taking care of me throughout this journey. Ya Aba al-Fadl, you're the one who set up my tent. You helped me dismount and get into my tent. Now look at me, oh brother, Ya Abbas. I'm surrounded by the enemies.
There is no one to help me ride my camel, Ya Abu al-Fadl.
It is as if Abu al-Fadl replies back. The poets try to point, draw this picture for us. As if he responds back to her and he tells her, Ya Zainab.
Don't blame me, forgive me, Ya Zainab. But they cut off my right hand, they cut off my left hand. They shot me with an arrow in my eye, Ya Zainab. If I had my sword with me, that would have never happened, Ya Zainab. Forgive your brother.
Then she started looking around. Where is Sukaina, the daughter of Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam? She saw her hugging the body of her father, crying and weeping. Abataya,
man الذي حز وريدك؟ أبا من الذي خضب شيبتك؟ Oh father, who beheaded you? Why are you covered with arrows and spears?
Zainab alayhi salam came to her.
And then the enemies of Allah came to her. They started hitting her, dragging her right off the body of her father. She started crying, looking at the body, saying, Oh father, do you see what they're doing to me? Do you see what they're, how they're treating me? Inna lillah.
وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ وَسَيَعْلَمُ الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا أَيَّ مُنْقَلَبٍ يَنْقَلِبُونَ وَالْعَاقِبَةُ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ Raise your hands in dua, brothers and sisters. Inshallah, this is the time when dua is accepted. The hajat are fulfilled. Laylatul Jumu'ah. We are here, the guest of Imam al-Husayn, salamullahi alayhi. We also just read dua kumayl. Inshallah, now du'as are accepted. So everybody together, and we have many hajat, many mu'mineen who asked us to pray for them, to remember them in our du'as. Let's pray together. A'udhu billahi minash shaytanir rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. أَمَّا يُجِيبُ الْمُضْطَرَّ إِذَا دَعَاهُ وَيَكْشِفُ السُّوءَ 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 أَمَّا يُجِيبُ الْمُضْطَرَّ إِذَا دَعَاهُ وَيَكْشِفُ
اللهم إنا نسألك وندعوك باسمك العظيم الأعظم الأعز الأجل الأكرم together 10 times يا الله 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 يا إلهي بفاطمة وأبيها وبعلها وبنيها والسر المستودع فيها اكشف عنا السوء يا الله اللهم اغفر ذنوبنا كفر عنا سيئاتنا وتوفنا مع الأبرار يا الله مع محمد وآله الأطهار يا الله اللهم اجعلنا وذريتنا إلى يوم الدين من شيعة أمير المؤمنين المتقين يا الله ومن خدمة الحسين المخلصين يا الله اللهم اقض حوائج المؤمنين والمؤمنات شافي وعافي جميع مرضى المؤمنين والمؤمنات على الخصوص من أوصونا بالدعاء منهم اللهم اقض حوائجهم شافي مرضاهم احفظهم في أوطانهم وديارهم بحفظك ورحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين رب اغفر لي ولوالدي وارحمهما كما ربياني صغيرا اجزهما بالإحسان إحسانا وبالسيئات غفرانا رب اجعلني مقيم الصلاة ومن ذريتي ربنا وتقبل دعاء اللهم عجل لوليك الفرج واجعلنا من شيعته وأنصاره وأعوانه والمستشهدين بين يديه. اللهم كن لوليك الحجة ابن الحسن صلواتك عليه وعلى آبائه في هذه الساعة وفي كل ساعة وليا وقائدا ودليلا حتى تسكنه أرضك طوعا وتمتعه فيها طويلا برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم أرنا الطلعة الرشيدة والغرة الحميدة واكحل أنظارنا بنظرة منا إليه. اللهم نقسم عليك بالزهراء فاطمة إلا ما رزقتنا شفاعة الزهراء في الدنيا وفي القبر وفي الآخرة يا الله يا الله يا الله، لقضاء الحوائج ولشفاء المرضى ولكشف هذه الغمة عن هذه الأمة ولتعجيل فرج مولانا صاحب العصر والزمان، وإلى أرواح المؤمنين والمؤمنات لا سيما أرواح عمات الجالسين والحاضرين. رحم الله من يقرأ السورة المباركة الفاتحة مع الصلوات.